things. I'm not used to the whip.
What's up, Prime fam? Sorry, I got to talk a little quietly. I don't want to interrupt a session going on back there, but we're in the gym and we're doing the pull hypertrophy workout from the Fusion program over at prime-strength.com. Guys, I'm fucking dead. So this program's starting to get really hard. The reason why is because it's starting to get a little heavier, but it's still very volume dense. And my diet now has brought me to body weight levels of 212 to 213 pounds about on average. My highs are about 215 right now. My lows are around 212, 211. So I'm really, really depleted. I haven't been this light literally in about 4 years. Actually, when I first met Kristin about 4 years ago, was about the lightest I had been. And boy.
Before
I let myself go. So I'm feeling dead, but we started off with some beltless deficit deadlifts. And the goal here is just a ton of volume accumulation. Now, this week I admittedly cheated a little bit. I used a deadlift bar with metal plates. And I also realized the weeks before I was pulling on a deficit that was probably a little bit bigger than I had thought. I think it was closer to about 4 inches rather than 3. So this week we had measured mats, and this is definitely a 3-inch deficit. So it felt a lot easier this week, but I'm just depleted and dead. So I decided to actually keep it easy at 495, which I'm glad I did. Now, the ironic part here is that my grip was giving out on my right hand. The whip of a deadlift bar, especially metal plates, rips your hands open. In fact, it's really, really harder to grip a deadlift bar than it is a stiff bar. It's a contrary to what people think. It's a common misconception that deadlift bars are easier to grip because they're thinner. They actually open your hands more. So feeling pretty good from it, given that it was a little bit lighter this week. Next week, I'm gonna go apeshit on week number 4. So this is currently week 3, where we're kind of still accumulating volume, and then week 4 is our expression week where we go all out. So I actually purposely held back a little bit today. That way I could go crazy next week. So I'm excited for that. I'll be showing you guys that. Now, real quickly, I want to touch on deadlifts and how they train your back muscles for growth, hypertrophy, more than say a rack pull. The common misconception is that rack pulls are superior for growth and bodybuilders should do rack pulls and powerlifters should do deadlifts from the floor. I completely disagree with this. The reason why has to do with fiber alignment and the angle of resistance. So because you are more bent over in the start position of a deadlift than a rack pull, you're actually gonna displace more of that tension onto the back extensors, both T-spine and lumbar spine extensors, as well as the traps and everything else going on in your back. When you're more vertical, you're mostly contributing all that tension to the upper trap. So contrary to what everyone thinks, it's actually a little bit better on the total back muscles, all the way from T-spine down to L-spine. I'm gonna check back in with you guys in a second. I gotta go on and do my wide grip deadlifts.
Damn, Kristin looking yokes, though. Back and arm muscles. Let's go, baby. She's got the 65s. And she's got the heel elevated. Look at that back position. Those are so easy. I feel like you could do 70, 75.
Was I going low enough?
Yeah, you were. Those look good. That was like perfect ROM. Explain to them like end range hip flexion and how going too deep is not gonna actually benefit you.
If you go too deep, you're just gonna end up flexing the back and actually not hinging at the hips. You're gonna be here, and then once the hips can't move back anymore, you're gonna start kind of bending through the back instead.
So. Show them your deepest end range hip extension. Hip flexion. Right about there. Now keep going deeper and watch what happens. You see how the back starts to round?
Either the back will start rounding or the knees will start bending.
Yep.
Yeah.
We're only training the glutes and hips here. We'll be right back. plate loaded up. Kristin on the hammer iso row. She's going top grips with elbows slightly tucked, just a little bit. This is going to train more upper back. If she went elbows really tucked with those like narrow grip handles, it's going to be more mid-low lat. And if she went underhand, that's real, real low lat. And then a little bit more bicep, but there's ways around that. Your elbow angle, the way it's going to articulate through the movement, it's going to dictate where you get the activation. So this is more of a retraction dominant row. All rows have retraction and should be done with active retraction. That was actually really solid for that weight. That was really good. But the ones with the elbows out is going to dictate more of that upper back region, and the elbows in is going to be more lats. My turn.
Okay, hopefully I'm in frame. So sorry, it's been a little hard to talk in here. We're working around the owner. He's super, super cool, but he does personal training sessions in here. So when he's in here with the client, I'm not trying to scream and take up his space with, you know, fucking camera and stuff. Not everyone wants to be on camera and they don't want to hear someone talking on YouTube. Anyway, finishing up on some back work here. We got hamstrings too. So I got a lat pull down that I'm doing here. I did do chin-ups today, just a couple sets, which is on program to maintain my strength. But the truth is, actually out of all the movements that are losing strength, my chin-ups and pull-ups feel the weakest. I have no clue why. I think it's because they're placed so deep into the workout. By the time I get through the deficit deaths, I'm just depleted of energy, carbohydrates, substrate to keep the muscles producing ATP and keep them replenished. So those are taking a hit. So I just did a couple sets there, went as heavy as I could for some 6 reps, just got to 1 plate. That's pathetically weak for me, but went on to the hammer iso row, which is an amazing machine. So cool we have that here. But more importantly, after I'm doing lat pull downs and I'm doing it with a neutral grip. So the goal here is to create an arcing motion and really keep my elbows tucking in towards the bottom. So it's almost like I'm doing one of those lat pullovers that you see at like Gold's Gym down in Southern California, the Mecca. That lat pullover machine, I'm trying to mimic that motion with the lat pull down. And the key is in the bottom position to arch your chest out, and then the top, pull through like this and get all the way into that internally rotated stretch position and then come back down. So it's not quite as much range of motion, but it's an amazing way to get those lats involved in the lat pull down. When I go more wide grip, elbows out, there's gonna be a little bit more outer, upper lat, and then mid back. So really try to isolate that low lat, which is a weak point for me. I have good upper lats, really, really shitty low lats. About to hit some leg curls up here with Kristin as well.
Floss though?
No. Okay, so we just did hammer curls. If you guys saw my bicep video with the free bicep program, if not, go check out the video. Link will be in the description as well as the blog over at prime-strength.com. Has a free program with videos, and it's very, very based around biomechanics and science. Now in that video, I talked about training your brachioradialis, which is kind of like a forearm muscle that runs up here into the low bicep region, and then the brachialis, which sits in between the lower tricep and bicep and helps expand your arms out this way. I got naturally tiny arms, guys. I've had to build these things up with a lot of smart training. So the hammer curl, especially done in a crossbody pattern, but in all ranges, it's really gonna target brachioradialis / brachialis and get that lower portion of the arm more expanded. After that, we're gonna go into a contracted curl. So what I always call a shoulder flex curl variation, where the shoulders and elbows are in front of the body, we're in a flex position. This is gonna target more of that end range contraction on the biceps. It does two things. One, it trains a short head, which is on the inside, the fat portion of the bicep that gives you a little bit more girth, okay? If we're stretching behind the body, that would train more of that long head. So we're gonna train more short head, but beyond that, We're emphasizing peak contraction here, especially if we set up the dumbbell or cable resistance to do that. So it kind of alters the strength curve of the exercise differently than you would do with like a normal standing dumbbell curl, barbell curl. So we're gonna do some, probably spider curls on the cable maybe, I don't know. We're gonna play around with it, set it up and see here in a sec.